Well, as an undergraduate at the University of Delaware, my main interest to become an environmental biologist and an ecologist and study animals in the field. And I was heading in that direction until a course appeared in the catalog, Biological Rhythms, offered by a new faculty member, Steve Skopik. And I went to talk to him about it, and sounded really interesting. And so in my junior year, I took an upper level course. I mean, undergraduates could take it, but in biological rhythms, and was introduced to the field, and really fell in love with it. It was, in some sense, for me, it was a chance for me to bring together what I discovered about myself, that I was really an experimentalist, not an ecologist. I love spending all kinds of time in the woods, chasing after lizards and salamanders and stuff. As a high school kid, I had this enormous menagerie. I thought of myself as an ecologist, but in my early training as an undergraduate at Delaware, I really got into experimental biology and discovered that I had stronger strengths in those areas, because I had the wonderful opportunity to mix with some big name ecologists, they impressed me with their enormous recall of every single species and stuff, and my brain's not organized that way. I knew all the lizards and snakes in New Jersey and Pennsylvania and stuff, but I had hardly begun to understand the plants, you know. So I took this rhythms course from Steve Skopik, and really enjoyed it, and then ended up. Steve was a great teacher. He still is a great teacher, and he found in the catalog at University of Delaware something that hadn't been used in years. There was a senior thesis program. And he told me and a couple other top students in his class about it. So I signed up to do a senior research project for a degree with honors and distinction from the University of Delaware. And so I did a senior thesis project studying the interaction of light and temperature and entrainment of lizards, which I knew, you know, I knew the lizards well. I went over to the New Jersey Pine Barrens and caught the lizards I needed for the study and whatever. And then as a senior, when I was working on that project, Steve offered another course at the graduate level advanced undergraduates like myself could take, and it was a course in photoperiodism. So that was my real introduction to the field of photoperiodism. And because of Steve's course, I knew the insect and plant photoperiodism literature better than anyone in Mike Menaker's lab when I got there. So that sort of primed me to study photoperiodism in mammals. An interesting story is that when I wrote to Mike Menaker to inquire about doing a doctorate with him, he was very enthusiastic and said he would be able to get me support. And even though I was kind of applying late because I was in ROTC program at University of Delaware reluctantly, but I was, and I had took a while to arrange a delay from active duty to be able to pursue graduate education. So I originally got acceptance to go to graduate school at Delaware, but my kind professor, Steve Skopik, told me, but you know, you really shouldn't stay, Jeff, go. So I wrote Menaker, and I basically proposed to do Herb Underwood's thesis. And Mike, perhaps because he wanted me to come, neglected to tell me that Herb Underwood was already doing that work. So when I arrived in the lab, I found that Herb had found this guys coming from Delaware who's already worked on lizards and stuff, and Herb worked very hard and fast to fill up both cold rooms with new light tight boxes and lizards, and so there was no space left for me to do studies on lizards with temperature control. My response to that was to become really good friends with Herb Underwood, and I used to go out and help him catch lizards in the field and stuff, because that was dear to my heart, and look for, you know, what other project I might do. And there were a couple others. I did some work on sparrow photoperiodism, and for a while I was working with biotelemetry in sparrows, and I was going to look at the effects of, I know Sue Binkley had already looked at the effects of pineolectomy on avian body temperature. I'm trying to remember, I don't remember right now what it was I was going to do with that, but at some point I realized that no one was really pursuing the formal analysis of circadian photoperiodic time measurement in a mammal. And I asked Mike why they dropped it. And it was because they experienced very high variability in the photoperiodic response curve that they published. And also Sue Gaston hated hamsters, it turned out, or something. And so they dropped it. And I knew from studying the hamster literature, writer's work and whatnot, that there was something wrong there. I mean, the hamster photoperiodic literature, such as it was up to that point in time with writer's work, showed really clean photoperiodic responses. So I decided that it would be a good system, especially because Syrian hamsters were, it was already known that Syrian hamsters were really good wheel runners, really good clock organism. So it turns out while Mike Meneker was doing a Guggenheim fellowship in France, and Milt Stetson was in the lab, and he and I were talking, we decided to do the first experiment. But Milt and I were arguing, you know, over what was the best experiment to do. And Mike came back from France just in time to kind of side with me, and we ended up doing the resonance study that I began my thesis work with, you know, which was sort of a first step to expose hamsters to resonance T cycles in order to test for the circadian basis of photoperiodic time measurement. And when they came out so nicely and I published that paper in Science, then based on knowing Colin Pittendrig's work pretty well, I figured that the best way to further advance our knowledge of the system would be to do T-cycle experiments. Because, you know, in those days, we didn't know anywhere near as much as we know now about the complexity of the system, and one conceived of there being a clock and an output pathway, and yeah, the Arnold Eskin model, and with photoperiodism, the main questions were how does the circadian clock underlie this measurement of day length? Does it do it in a Bunning sort of fashion, where there is some unique physiological rhythm or something that is the rhythm of photosensitivity for photoperiodic induction, as Pittendrig had envisioned that there was a unique photo-inducible phase, and when that phase is brought into coincidence with light, that triggers the long day response. So the T-cycle experiment was an ideal way to try to find, and not just find, that photoperiodic phase if it existed, but actually map it with fairly discrete in training pulse of just an hour. So that's how I got into that. And as you know, I did additional experiments to complement the T-cycle studies. I did bi-stability and entrainment to skeletons and stuff like that. I feel incredibly blessed. I've had the wonderful opportunity to work with so many of the best and brightest in the field. Beginning with Steve Skopic, who his heart was never in the direction of making a big name for him in research, but he's a very, very good scientist and a good teacher, a fabulous teacher. So, you know, he taught me really well, and in the and then going to work with Mike Meneker, and while I was still in Mike's lab, I worked with Fred Turek, you know, and in fact, I taught Fred Turek how to work with hamsters, and he came up to me at an SRBR meeting just about 6 years ago or so, and put his arm around me, and he said, "Jeff, no, I don't think I ever really thanked you. So I want to really thank you for teaching me how to work with Syrian hamsters." Fred came into the lab on fire. I mean, he's always been a go-getter. And, you know, what did he, I think he finished his doctorate with Abo and Pitt at Stanford in like 3.5 years or something. And he came to the Meneker lab really ready to go. And I think very quickly decided that, you know, to really craft a successful career for himself, he wanted to get into the hamster system and take it and run. And so we did a lot of experiments together early on with when his primary focus was photoperiodic control of negative feedback on the hypothalamus, so testosterone negative feedback regulating LH and FSH. So we did a lot of those studies together. And for quite a while, I thought I would really, focus a lot on that. You know, trying to figure how am I going to really get a good job and everything. You know, I was very much into neuroendocrinology and reproductive endocrinology, and probably if you know, I could have pursued that path. I mean, I've stayed in it to some degree. I'm still a hormone assayist to some degree. When I left Mike's lab to do a postdoc, I went to Stanford to work with Pitt. And, what a wonderful opportunity that was, because he was fabulous. As you well know, I mean, he was.
Tell us a couple of stories. Whiskey on the head.
Well, yeah.
No scientific.
Yeah, Pitt was a good partier. He really did enjoy partying, and he loved scotch. He loved really good scotch, and he loved reggae music. So when I remember at the 1977 Clocks Workshop that Pitt organized at Hopkins Marine Station. One night, it's not the only time Pitt did this, but one night we were dancing to reggae music, and Pitt started doing his famous, he could, like no one else in this world, he could dance with a martini glass of good scotch whiskey on his head, and we all tried to stay with him. I mean, no one could stay with him. You could balance it for a little while, but I don't know if I ever saw a glass roll off of Pitt's head. I mean, that he had to catch it. He could dance and keep it up there forever.
I saw that once.
And another really fabulous non-science memory, in a sense, from those days is when we had the Clocks Workshop. Scientists came to be lecturers and faculty for this 6 week, I think it was 6 week workshop that we had at Hopkins Marine Station, from all over the world. And of course, Pitt's very good friend Jürgen Aschoff came. And I don't remember exactly, I mean, obviously I think Pitt knew Aschoff was coming, but somehow we managed to keep it from him exactly when. And Kathy Williams in Pitt's lab, she was one of his primary technicians at that time. I know she played a role in it, and Carl Johnson did. What took place is when Jürgen got there, we managed to put him in a rowboat, and I think I did the rowing. I'm not sure, but I think I did the rowing. I think Carl might have been in the boat with me. Maybe we were both rowing, but I don't remember exactly where we put the boat in, but it was someplace probably around behind the cannery or whatever, and we rowed Jürgen into what we used to call Agassiz Beach, behind the Agassiz building at Hopkins Marine Station. And Jürgen Aschoff brought this beautiful flag with him, colorful flag, and we rowed him in, and somehow there was something going on. Well, there was lots of people already there, I guess, with Pitt was outdoors on the beach talking to people, and all of a sudden he sees his friend Jürgen Aschoff being rowed in from the ocean. and Pitt was, he was so elated and stuff. He actually, walked out in the water to greet the boat before it got to shore. As you know, they were wonderful friends as well as, in some sense, competitors. Yeah. So that was a neat thing to see.
If you look back on those years, the concepts at the time, they were all still growing, or the concepts were there, and the experiments had to be done to fill in the reality. So can you comment on where the field was at that time when, you were doing your bit in it?
There was a major focus on thinking that if we could just find the spot in the brain where the clock was, which had been, was encouraged by early studies in insects, the work in the cockroach by Shep Roberts, focusing on I forget the name of the area. Junko Uo's work, so no one knew where the clock was in the mammal. While I was at about the time I arrived in Mike Maneker's lab, it was not too long after the fabulous study from that Sue Gaston and Mike Maneker published, showing that the removal of the pineal gland from the sparrow resulted in arrhythmicity. And so the pineal appeared to be the locus of the clock in the bird, and we knew that in the mammal, that the mammals that had been studied, that was not the role the pineal was playing. It was very important in regulating seasonal reproduction. And in those days, really didn't know that it was the circadian aspect of the melatonin production that was so important. I would say, the mindset in those days was an expectation that we'll find. Our job is to find the central pacemaker, and then figure out what its connections are to the rest of the body, and is it endocrine or is it neural or is it both? But pretty limited set of possibilities, supposedly. You know, you never would have envisioned in those days the level of complexity. You know, and it's interesting too. I mean, the discussions about the genetics. You know, Pitt was a geneticist and trained under Dobzhansky, and he would have loved to have been one of the first to, you know, to identify a clock gene. But his training and the biases of the time told him that it would be a fruitless endeavor to try to, you know, to try to mutate and find a clock gene or whatnot. I don't know why they thought it would be so hard, you know, but it took Ron Konopka going to Seymour Benzer's lab, you know, to do that and prove that, you know, that bias was wrong. It's not going to be that hard. And then, of course, Joe Takahashi, many years later, mutagenizing mice to get the clock gene, was a huge undertaking. But you know, at least they figured, you know, they knew that it was possible to do. Pitt made fantastic contributions to the field, but his focus really was more on trying to discern and bring out what the formal properties of the system were, not just entrainment, you know, but also questions of oscillator-oscillator interactions with his fruit fly A and B oscillator scheme, and you know, he was always trying to improve the understanding in terms of oscillator theory and with his experiments.
That gave you E and M.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you went with it.
Oh yeah. I mean, when the Pittendrieg and Don papers came out, actually I had heard some of it had come out in various forms before that, you know. But when those papers came out, I read them thoroughly and absorbed them and figured that, you know, I wanted to look at whether photoperiodic time measurement in the Syrian hamster would fit under that scheme and regulation of the melatonin rhythm. So yeah, I did a lot of work that was driven by the idea that that the change in phase relationship between oscillators comprising the pacemaker, beginning with the simple concept that it was that there was an evening and a morning oscillator, might be the basis of not only photoperiodic switching in terms of, but you know, regulation of the seasonal change in the duration of the melatonin rhythm, and in more globally in one of the, what I think is an understudied area of rhythms still today, because our focus is so much on the molecular and whatnot, is at the behavioral and ecological level. There's a property of rhythms which we'll call waveform, which has been severely neglected. You know, circadian programming of the actual waveform of the rhythm can have real important physiological consequences. You know, the clearest example is the waveform of the melatonin rhythm, because we know what a strong functional role that plays in the timing of annual reproductive cycles. But it isn't just tau and a simple phase angle. I mean, many rhythms change their waveform as a function of season, and that we don't really we don't understand well how that's accomplished. Although in a vague sense, I think we feel that, you know, some sense it's accomplished by reorganization in the FCN in terms of oscillator-oscillator phase relationships. But it, you know, it can be a, it could be a lot more complex than that. Oscillators within the SCN may be changing, maybe changing their amplitude or what they're doing, not just their phase relationships. Lipindri and Don papers introduced the concept that that there was history dependence and photoperiodic regulation of the entrainment response itself. So not only does entrainment change as a function of season, but the underlying mechanism for entrainment, the phase response curve, may be molded by season. And they did a study that supported that idea, but they only looked at the effect of light at one particular phase in mice. And so one of the things I set out to do when I was a postdoc in Pitt's lab at Hopkins Marine Station was to study photoperiodic modulation of the phase response curve. So I did a large number of studies that showed that there was a very systematic relationship between the amplitude and the waveform in terms of how broad the responsive region of the PRC is. And it what those studies showed is that there was a really nice correlation between the breadth of the phase response curve's most responsive or active region, measuring from when you get significant delays in the early subjective night to when advances trail off in the late subjective night. You can measure that, the area from the beginning of delays to the end of advances, as the responsive region of the phase response curve. That region expands with activity time and compresses with activity time. And one of the findings of those studies that has not yet been published is that under in the most extreme case, I found that if you compress alpha to the vanishing point, that it was that there was no statistical phase shift response left. And so on the one hand, in the Syrian hamster, although everyone now knows that the tau mutant, if left to free run for 49 days in constant darkness, has a type zero phase response curve, a high amplitude phase response curve, which is not seen normally in the wild type. In two different strains of wild type Syrian hamsters, I found that under the influence of skeleton photopreate and dim scotophase illumination, I would get very long alphas where the mean alpha for the group being tested was over 12 hours. And if you do a phase response curve when the Syrian hamster is in that state, it's type zero. And on the other end of the continuum, if you drive the Syrian hamster clock with a T cycle that it cannot entrain to, a T of 23, alpha compresses and compresses and compresses until eventually entrainment is broken. And so what I did was drive alpha to the point where I knew that entrainment would be lost within a cycle or two, and at that point released the animals into constant dark and gave light pulses at all different phases. And the analysis of that showed at no phase was there a significant phase shift. So it looks like there is, you know, a very large continuum of from almost no response or no response at all to type zero that is related to the length of alpha in Syrian hamsters. And we believe that length of alpha, which also reflects the duration of elevated melatonin, in the Syrian hamster is a reflection of phase relationships among these 10,000 neurons in the SCN, which change as a function of photoperiod. So the system is extremely adaptable. And what I'm studying now, the work that Mike Gorman and I started 5 or 6 years ago, we're really enthralled with the effects of dim light during the SCOTA phase. And what we've been able to show is that if you provide dim light as in contrast with total darkness, which is normally used in the laboratory to simulate night, it makes a profound difference in how hamsters of two different species and mice, we've only done limited work with mice, but how they respond to the bright light that's normally provided in a laboratory situation. So to be more specific, if hamsters have dim light instead of total darkness, the response to short days where alpha expands and the melatonin rhythm expands is greater and more rapid. If you compare dim SCOTA phase illumination to absolute darkness for night, if you give hamsters a light-dark cycle, be it 8-4 or 7-5, and challenge the clock to split, the clock splits very readily with dim SCOTA phase illumination, and without it, almost no hamsters split. If you look at entrainment to T cycles, the limits of entrainment that I showed in my PhD thesis with 1 hour bright light pulses is very narrow in the Syrian hamster with a type 1 phase response curve. It's from 23.2 to 24.7 hours. If you give hamsters dim SCOTA phase illumination, you can drive them to T30 or T18. So our working hypothesis is that we don't know what at the molecular or cellular level what the mechanism is, but from a conceptual point of view, looking at all the different paradigms we've studied, it looks like the most productive view is that dim light is somehow changing oscillator-oscillator interactions in the SCN in the direction that we would conceptually say is loosening the coupling. It's making the circadian pacemaker less tightly coupled and therefore more easily shifted. And most recently, the most recent paradigm that we've explored, and this is wonderful work that Jen Evans presented in a poster last night, is that we've shown that with dim light during the SCOTA phase, Syrian and Siberian hamsters phase shift in a jet lag paradigm much more rapidly than animals that have absolute dark. You might think that the effect of dim SCOTA phase illumination might be to directly influence the response to bright light as a phase shifting cue, but we've tested that. And if we give bright light on top of dim light, and look at phase shifts induced by a light pulse, there is no difference. The only paradigms in which we demonstrate this difference are ones in which the only explanation is something's happening with the coupling. Alpha is expanding. It's expanding more rapidly with dim light. Or, you know, so we think that there's an exciting new effect of light on the circadian system, and it's modulating coupling. And I have a poster here in which I'm presenting the beginnings of an action spectra study to look at what is the actual sensitivity to dim light. We didn't know that. We've been doing these studies with a level of dim light that works, but not knowing exactly what. So we've now got fluence response curves for 560 nanometer green, 590 nanometer yellow, and 695 nanometer red light. And the data for blue is very, very interesting and complex, but I can't fit a sigmoid curve to it at this point in time. But the first take-home message is the sensitivity to effects of dim light is at least three orders of magnitude lower than the sensitivity to light for phase shifting. So the EC50 for 560 nanometer green light is 9.5 log units, photons per centimeter squared per second. And for various phase shifting studies, it's always up around 12 log units.
This has been a lesson.